This conference will now be recorded.
Hello everyone, hope you're fine. Welcome to my first session of Salesforce courses. My name is Christoph Lieske. I just Salesforce developer since 2013. I invited you via LinkedIn because I've got the idea to make the market a little bit better. Just this build like we will go to, through user stories, and those user stories are coming right from my practice, and you will get comfortable to my company, also the insights. It's echoing, interesting. I don't know, it shouldn't be anything but my, are you fine? Okay, for those who can't hear, please go to, well, please go to the options. Yeah, I think headphones are fine, correct. Just to be comfortable, I will not look through the chat because it's a little bit interrupting, I think. Anyway, we can, well, you can listen to the YouTube video anyway because it's recorded, so it's not a big deal. The course will be like user stories, as I said before. At the end of this week, I will provide another user story to show you the task for the interested people of you. All of you will get the task to have the chance to solve this. And after solving the task, I will go through it and I will choose some people to get into my company a little bit, just like you will get a sandbox, and then you have access to the code of my inner party. And but from now, the user story I will give to you is not about the company. It's about some stuff, some new task relating to this course, because I needed to. For sure, but it's you don't need to have information about my company to solve the task. Okay. Anyway, let's see. Yes, I will show you my screen. I guess you already had a look on the task. Sorry for not translating it. It's in German, but I think you already translated it. The next few tasks will be in English for sure, but this one is in German by now. But I think it's not a big deal. So the task, this is the first I'm doing. I will just introduce the task into English for sure. And But I guess you already had a look on it and translated it via Google Translator or something. In German, it is Arbeitszeiten des Google Drive automatisch nach Salesforce laden. In English, it's load working times from Google Drive to Salesforce automatically. It's like I want to have the working times out of Google and want to put it into Salesforce. Yeah, I will show it later on. I think it's understandable. This is the user story in my company. There's an abbreviation for this. Abbreviations are used in user stories to recognize some different objects like change sets. Because we are linking the change sets to the user stories, so we can recognize some metadata later on. For example, we have changed something in a class, and then we save the class, and then we put the class into an outbound change set, like here. Yeah, you can see a little bit. And that is like an overview of what you have done and in which objects you already changed something. That is important to deploy it later on from sandbox to another environment. It can be another sandbox as a UAT, for example, or it can be the production. Yeah, The sandbox is like you're playing around and then you're putting it to another sandbox to make it more like a production. For every user story, I have a number, not for this one because the number was created later on. That's why there's no number. The status, this one is executing now. The status is to determine in which status is the user story, which kind of conditions they have, and there are different kind of status. I'm not going into detail, but it's like to have an overview about the user stories and exactly where are they. The priority is there to have a priority, and the link to the dev is like you can go quickly to the dev environment of this user story. You don't need to because I already opened it, but if you want to open it, you can click it here. And this is like the rhythm. The rhythm is for me daily. There's also weekly, monthly, and something. Of course, basically, daily user stories will have more value than weekly user stories because they are happening daily and not weekly. I will just use the outcome out of the user story more often. Okay, so to explain the user story itself. As a work or as a manager, I want that working times out of Google will be loaded to Salesforce automatically, so that I've got an overview or survey. As you already get it out of this little phrase, there will be some working times. The working times will be in Excel format that is written in Google Drive. Yeah, that's very important because we need to know where the data is located. That is always you have to figure out, just figure out where the data is and write it down and be sure and comfortable in the head with it. That's the role, who wants something. That's important for profiles, for example, or for roles, because there are different levels of visibility of data and also different rights you can share. And you want to put it into Salesforce. Yeah? Salesforce is a target environment. So we have a source environment, that's Google Drive, and the target environment, that's Salesforce. And so that is very important to know, and because that's the 80% work you have to do as a developer. You have to figure out where's the source, what kind of data you have, which kind of structure this data has. We will go into detail later on, and which target you have and which kind of data structure you already have in your target environment. So you have an overview. It can be a different kind of task. It depends on the acceptance criteria you have in the user story. So that's the first hint you have in the user story to solve the problem. Yeah, you have the name, you have the short description. And to make it a real user story, we need to have acceptance criteria. We in our company just introduced some colors. There's one Pivot user story we created. So there's the legende, just like to explain what the color exactly means. We have five different kinds of statuses. I just didn't want to introduce another field. So for us, it was enough to put in a color. Yeah. And you have here the red color. It's the first. If you open this one, then it's open. If it is just black, then it means then it has written down, but nobody else or nobody has really thought about it, if it's valid or not. Yeah? If it is really red and open, and then it, you make sure that it is valid. Yeah? That's the code for this. And you have to put the code just to change the color. Yeah? In Salesforce, there are rich texts. That's a rich text. There are different kinds of fields. Just to make you a little bit comfortable with that, it's for example, there's a checkbox or a text box or a number, also a date. And this one is a rich text format. And rich text can have up to, I think, 131,000 signs or something. And you can do a couple of things with that, just like to attach some pictures, to underline something, to strike through something, to make it bold and something like this. And so you can put the color into it. Yeah. And the color I showed earlier, you can put it in here, just like maybe completed. Yeah. Or let's say open. Let's say we go in here. Take this one, maybe Arbeitszeiten werden in die richtige Code eingefügt. In English, it is working times will be attached to the right quote. Yeah? And then you're just selecting the stuff or the text. You're going to here and then overwrite this one. Hit enter. Then you need to click it and then done. Yeah? And then you have changed the color. So this is pretty important because that is to not lose the overview. Yeah, okay, that's the one. So those ones we already finished. That's why they are yellow. The functionality is already developed in the development environment. That's why it's yellow. And the orange ones are like executing. Yeah, we are still at this point. Yeah, it's like the working times should be in Salesforce, and that's the point we are at this moment. We already put this stuff, and I'm not going to expand it again. I will develop right away, just to not annoy you a little bit. But I think if we need some introduction to make you comfortable with user stories, to make you comfortable with the color system, and now I think we are able to go into the code. If there are any questions, just write me an email. Just go to the YouTube channel afterwards. I will upload the video there, and then you can say at time that and that this is this question, and then I will answer you. It's not a big deal. From now on, I just will give you some instructions. So we are here. The working times should be available in Salesforce. Yeah? And so first of all, I will go to Google and show you some the data we prepared for this. As you can see here, I've got a structure in here. And so the data will be written here, like need to go to it a little bit. No, not that's for my workers, correct? And I guess we have, yes, this one. That's our test folder. And though in this folder you will find some folders and data and so on, and the whole structure must be like there's a folder, and in this folder there needs to be another folder like Arbeitszeiten. Yeah, that's the stuff, and the other folders will be ignored because there's no folder within this folder that is called Arbeitszeiten. And if it's loading, it's not. Doesn't load. Okay. Anyway. Yeah, as you can see here, there's no Arbeitszeiten in it, and that's why that's not a valid folder for the Arbeitszeiten. But this one here will be a valid folder, and that's why it's going into it. And then it will go through all the data in here and make sure that all the data written in here will go to Salesforce. So first of all, we need to have a look on this data. Let's see, that's a copy of real data. It's be prepared for this just a little bit. As you can see here, we have a date, we have a time, from time, until time, and time in hours. the title for the working time and the description for the working time. Yeah. And that's a weird structure in here, but we need to put it to Salesforce for sure. That's why we need to read it out. Yeah, we prepared a little bit code already for this. So to make it a little bit comfortable with that, let's go through the code. And yeah, let's have a look on it. And it's a little bit structured like this. We have a ticket up here. Yeah, that's a ticket, the user story we already put in here. And we have the user story. Let me see. And this user story we have, it's just the name of the class. Yeah? That's the user story in here. So this is just to be able to understand it a little bit more. And if you want to have more details, we put a, we have put the ticket in here, and we named the class like the abbreviation. So to link the class to the change set and also to the user story. Okay, AC is like acceptance criteria. So we are able to say this was implemented because of acceptance criteria 3. And then we have here acceptance criteria 1, yeah, and also 2, but we didn't yeah, put it. So for the first one, it's like, just to show the code a little bit. So you see, I'm just trying to make it comfortable with the system, and we are not making something by activity by now, but tomorrow it's, it will go a little bit more detailed, but I think we have also enough time to today. So the first one, acceptance criteria 1 is this one. And every data must be a notification or a notice. Yeah, that's this one. So that this data has been loaded to Salesforce. This one I wanted to put something into description. So if we are in the folder, we can look it up. So in details and scroll down a little bit. And as you can see here, we already have some descriptions changes. And so at this time, this is just in German, but it's not, I think it's fine. It just deals with the notice. And so it's fine. Just to show you, it's just, I will just put it out, yeah, change it, and then we refresh it. After refreshing, we see that for sure nothing is in here, yeah, no description. And so we go into the code. As you can see here, we have a method called set descriptions of Google files. That's just for several Google files. You will have a loop. If you want to know what's a for loop and so on, I can yeah, give you a link to the what is it called, a developer guide. Salesforce developer guide, that's a pretty good one. You don't need to read every single page. If you just have a topic, go through it, because it's about 2,000 lines or something. I won't give you the hint to read through the whole document, just read the parts you need, nothing more. Yeah, that's not worthwhile. After some years, you will have it in your mind anyway. So that's not for reading out it, yeah? From my perspective and out of my experience. So we have a loop in here. That's a for loop. This is like you're going through every single element in this map. Yeah, we'll be defining a string variable. It's like the file ID, that's the name of the variable. And we go through every single element in the key set. How to explain a map. A map is like you're putting a string, or for this example, you can put different kind of objects in here, or different kind of types. For this example, this is a type of strings. String is like a text chain, like a chain of characters or letters. Yes, it's more than letters, it's characters. So you put something into the map and you will get something out of the map. For this example, we are putting an ID into the map and then we get out the Google file IDs. Yeah, that's the description in here. Yeah? That's why we want to set the description. And so we're putting for this Google file ID, we get this description. So first of all, we are going through the elements of keys. So the file IDs, and then we say set description. And for this, we already made or created a method. This method is called set description, and we will try it out later on or very soon. Just let me explain at first, and then we can go through it. So that's like the static. Yeah, that's first of all, it's public. Because of the public, you can call it from everywhere and within your environment. That's why it's public, and you can call it from every class. If it would be private, you would also be only be able to call it from here, not from anywhere else. It's static, so you can call it from the class itself. You don't need to have an instance of it. Yes. Genau. And the string is like it's giving back some information. Yeah, that's about the set description. What it will exactly give you, I will explain. So it's called set description. You will give some parameters into it, just like food. Yeah? Food to get something out. You're giving a file ID into the set description, and also the description that should be set. Yeah? As you can see here, you have the data or the file, and in the URL you will see the ID. And this ID is exactly the ID we will using. And to set the description, it will be written in here. That's exactly the same as we are using in this method. That's one-on-one equalization. So that's why we didn't use any comments, because you need to understand it, and the comments would blow up the codes too much. That's why we just going like clean code. Yeah, we are setting the method itself, and we are making it as brief as possible. And so you have a good overview about the method and what it's doing it and what not. Yeah. For this example, it's just like four lines of codes, and okay, here's a little bit more, but we are not finished yet above here. Okay, the set description is like we need to get a controller. It's like to get a connection to Google. For this, we need to make some options in the admin console of Google. It's like written in the let me see. I will show you. It's written in the documentation of Google. I have it in here. I will just show you some overview. For example, that's a developer console. I will show you just to make it comfortable, at least a little bit, with the links between them. As long as it's loading, I will show you something else as well. Let me see. There's also the Google Drive API. Application Programming Interface, that's the one I'm using. And if you have any questions about specific stuff, you should go in here. Sometimes you need to get into version 2, because it's not implemented in version 3 yet, but most of all, you should prefer the version 3, because it's more valuable. So in here, we have the APIs and also the credentials. And in the credentials, you will create some client IDs and so on. I will not show you the whole ID in here, but also not the client secret, but that's the whole structure in it. Yeah, you can put some client IDs in here and get some client secrets, and then you can put it into the code in the background or in the object I made, and then you're fine with that. So that's exactly what it's doing. It's calling the loaded structure. So it's already authenticating. I will not going not go pretty much into detail for this because there's a couple of stuff in here you can read out to understand this and also try it out in here. Now the first or the best to do would be to try it out, yeah, just to be able to understand it. Okay. First of all, we need this Google connection one. And if you achieve it to solve the issues I will provide at the end of the week, you will get the code anyway, and you will get all the stuff you need. You get really every single information, but at this point, I keep it a little bit secret. I created a class called HTTP Google Request. There are some routines just like to get some content out of the data, some metadata, to change names, to change description, and something like this. And so that is exactly what we are doing. We are setting the file ID. That is what we need to do. It's already in this method in here because I already prepared it and packet it. And here you can see we are changing the metadata, and that's exactly what we are getting back. Yeah? Some information about the data, what has been changed. Okay. I will show you how it works. So we want to get some output. That's why I'm putting the DML exception. Yeah. This is something here I leave alone, just comment it out. And as parameter, the exception needs a string, not just a text. And then we put in the file ID. No, we're putting in out of this class, we are going to set the description. And we're going to set the description for the file ID we get out of here because we want to change the file ID out of it. And just to make sure we are getting the right data, we are just going double click this one. We are going like double click into the URL, just hit string C or whatever combination you have to save some data in between, and then I will insert it in here. And that's the first parameter I need. The second one is like test. Yeah, I'm just putting test in here. As you can see here, nothing is written in here. I will just refresh it again. Nothing is written in here. Yeah, we will hit execute. In here, there's a mistake. There's an error. Why is there an error? Set description. Let me see why it's an error. Let me see. Execute again. Line 3, column 43, line at extra. There's too much. Okay. Actually, okay. There's too much. Okay. Some mistakes are happening. It's not a big deal. You just have to go through it and execute now. And so another mistake. What the? Actually, that's This should be it. DML exception, yes. Ah, okay, no. Ah. Another parenthesis. We need this for this one and also for the exception one. Yeah. Execute, as you can see, you can be comfortable with that as you want to. You just need to concentrate always. Yeah. And so you can see that it has worked. Yeah, for this one, that's just data that's it will call out just to show you it did something. Yeah. I will not go through all the stuff. I will just refresh this one and will show you the description and that it worked. So the description is in here, and now we have test in it. Before it was nothing, now it's test. Yeah. And as you can see, the best thing to understand things is to go through it, practice it, try it out. And so we have a feeling for set description. And the set description is setting the description as it says. Yeah. And that's a method we are using for different kind of stuff later on. Yeah. If you have any questions, just put it via email or just write under the YouTube video once it is online. I will put it online, I think, after this meeting right away, or at least until tomorrow. Okay. There are different kind of things. We need some more stuff because there's a little bit more in it. I try to speed it up a little bit just to make it comfortable. I will not go through every single line. I just try to make it comfortable with that. So let's go. As I already said, there's a specific structure in it. Behind the scenes, there is an object or a data called Google Connection or HTTP Connection. And in this connection, there's some specific information about client secret and ID and so on. I won't show it to you because it should be internal by now, but internally it's used to connect to Google and to connect to the specific credentials we created in here. Yeah, it's, some kind of here. Okay, let me close it, this one. So the create working times, it's like the acceptance criteria 3 we already spoken about. It's this one here, but like to remember, the working times should be there as data sets, or as data in, it's like records in Salesforce. Yeah. So the first of all, we need to know where the source data is, which kind of source or which source data we want to have, and where is the target? That is something we need to know. After a couple of trainings or practices, it's pretty obvious. If you're not comfortable with the system or with the code, we need some practice for sure. As in the other methods, we need to get the Google connection at first. It's always first because we need to authenticate at Google. That's exactly happening in here. After this, we need to put it into the HTTP Google request. You don't need to know everything about this. You just need to know that you can do something with that, how it is in the background. We are not going through it. It's just like you're ordering shoes from Zalando or from books from Amazon or something, and you don't need to know the process in background. But we have the ID of the order, of the file, yeah, of the folder. That's this one here. That's the ID or the ID I've put in the background on this specific record. And so we can take it here to use this ID to take the children, all the children of this folder. So it's taking every single child. Yeah? That is what's called in here the map. And then We need to make a list out of it to be able to go through it with a loop. And so we are creating the children list. It's like this format because it's mandatory for this. And so there's a it's a structure like map, as you can see in here. Yeah, that's why we are getting it like map. And you can get a map just to put in this case a string or text. It's items, and the items in this case are just the children. Yeah? And then you can get all the children in the folder. So now it is going through every single record. What you're defining here, you're going like object through the children list, and then you go, the child has a specific structure. The structure is called here. And then you can get the child ID from the structure, for example, like this, because it's getting the ID out of the child map. As it is a string, we need to cast it to the string, and then it is going to be like a child ID string. Yeah? This is the string we need to put into the request, and then we get the metadata string, like the description. I just don't want to overwrite the description, and that's why we are getting description and also the MIME type, just to be able to determine which kind of data is it. Is it a folder? Is it a doc file? Is it an Excel file? Is it a picture? Is it something? Yeah, that's called a MIME type. You can also have a look on the MIME types in Google. Let me see, MIME type. Yeah, this one. MIME type is in here. That's the one I've chosen because you have a quick overview about the MIME types, or about a couple of MIME types. It's the most chosen ones, I think, if you want to go through it. If you want to check something, you have to take this one because that's the kind you have to write it into the code. It's like in here, like the folder, and we are determining if it's a folder or not. Yeah, it's like we only want to have this one, or this one, and not this one and this one, because in the first level we need to have a folder. Yeah, that's the structure. This is what you also can get via the MIME type. Then you're just saying if is it a correct MIME type. If yes, then go for it. It's taking the children from the folder because we know now it's a folder, so we can assume that they are also children. And if I will show you later on, if there's another folder in it called Arbeitszeiten, then we are fine. We just have to make sure all the different kind of levels and all the different conditions. Yeah? That is what makes developing uncomfortable or just complex. It's not really difficult. You just need to have an overview or just a structure to be able to go through it. Okay. And so it's like the same as above. Take the children, take the items, and then go through the items. Blah blah blah. Yeah, the same. Blah blah blah. Is it really a folder? Is the name really Arbeitszeiten? Then it's fine. Yeah. For this one, it will go through nothing, or it will go through this folder also, but it will skip it because it doesn't have this name. Yeah, it really has to have this name. And if it's not, it will skip. But that is necessary because all the folders have a specific structure. And that's the first step. You need to know to be a developer or to fix some processes or something. You always have to have a process structure at first. And then on this structure or the stipulation, you can determine something and derive something and develop, yeah, something like this. So it's pretty much the same. Again, if in this folder here, Arbeitszeiten, yeah, are some children, then go through it. Yeah. And blah, 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 the same as above. Yeah, it's like the same structure. If it's an Excel file, like in here, you know, always the MIME type. That's why the MIME type names are changing. It's always 1, 2, 3. Yeah. Always different kind of MIME types. I have also another MIME type. I just cover 2 MIME types. That's why there's an OR operator between them. It can be an Excel file, yeah, from my perspective, or also is a spreadsheet. Spreadsheets are created if you create it via Google, and then that's a spreadsheet. If you are loaded as an Excel file, it's just like an Excel file. You can also have some different kind of files, but you have to put it into here to accept it. If not, it's not accepted, and then the software will not work. If it should work, just put it in here. That's why I showed you the MIME types. Yeah? That's this one here. I don't think that the MIME types here are just complete. You can also do something like a spreadsheet. Yeah? I think that's always a spreadsheet. That's why, let me see, I guess, let me go through it. Spreadsheet. You can also say the MIME type 3 does not equal to null, and actually it shouldn't equal to null always, but I just double check, and I think I don't need to, but I'm just doing it. And then MIME type 3.contains, it's another method of the string. If you want to have an overview about the methods, you can go to the developer guide, for sure. You can go to, let me see, I'm using Ecosia because it's more comfortable with the environment. And let's say Salesforce Apex string. You can go to the string class, and you have an overview about the string class. It can also have an overview about objects and so on. It's all written in here. That's the Apex developer guide I mentioned before. You can download it in PDF if you want to read it out, even on the toilet, or if you're on the road or something. You can also just go to the web page here. You have some methods. If you want to get comfortable with the string methods, and you need to get comfortable with it, and maybe just to get idea about what you can do, and maybe it gives you a hint for what you should do. Yeah? Sometimes I'm also going through it just because to memorize it and to repeat it a little bit. I'm just not learning it by heart. I'm just try to link it to specific user stories I have right now. So the mind is not there to learn things by heart, but it can compare things to each other pretty well. And that's the whole strength we should use of our brain, just to make sure that you get the most out of it. Okay, then I say everything that is some kind of spreadsheet will be fine, and it goes on. Yeah. Oh, by the way, we have the acceptance criteria too in here. I will show you soon. And the last one is like set the ID, get or try to get the content, and then we are trying to put the content and do something with the content. Yeah? We decided to implement also this one through new DML exception, just because we wanted to have an outcome and want to know Yeah, what kind of data is put in here? Yeah. Right. So we have a chance to understand what's going on in the background. That's why we have just put the string list. For sure, there are also some different kinds of possibilities, just like system.debug, just to write down in the background. But then there will come some logs, and you have to download it and so on. And so with the throw new DNL exception, you have an answer right away, and you don't need to put some extra stuff in it. If you want to speed things up, as sometimes the data here can pretty big. This time is megabyte. It's taking a little bit time. And then let's say we make change the logs. We can set add some log levels. We can add log levels. We can change the log levels wherever we want to. Yeah. Maybe we can put it to the least information we want to have. I already prepared something, and I'm just debugging Apex code and mostly only debugs, just to have the debugs in it and to make it a little bit quicker. But it depends on which kind of data you need, which kind of data you need to figure out. And but at this point, it should be enough. And so let's try it again. Maybe we'll set a description as to be able to compare it. Don't be confused. We are not calling this method here. And we are just, again, the description, but I think it should be smaller. As you can see, yeah, quite smaller. Let's say I will show it in here in the folder. We have this data here. It's about 6 kilobytes, and this is some megabytes. That's quite bigger, yeah? About 4 times. And you can make things a little bit quicker with that, because you don't need to get all the information as a developer. You just need the information you put, and to be able to understand the things you are doing and the things that the system is doing. And so you can get used to the system, and also get to know how to change, what to change, how many or how much to change in the system, or even not to change. Okay, let's go through the exception criteria too. But this one, every loaded folder in Google Drive contains the information that the data of the file has been loaded to Salesforce fully. Yeah, it's nearly the same as here, but that is not calling the this one is not calling the data itself. It's calling the folder. For sure, for Google Drive, it is a data, but you only need to or have to put the description in or attend something to. Yeah, append something to the append, sorry. Append something to the description if all data has been put or loaded to Salesforce, yeah? All the stuff in here. So it's like if you are going to the code again, here we are going through every single data, and that's only the Arbeitszeiten, yeah? The data or the description is just like, let me see, the set this, we need to go through it. Set description, let me show you. It's, let me see, it's just, okay. It is set in here, just like the append description with date time. So it's put in here. We are putting the data, that's why we are putting the child too. Let me see. No, it's this one. Here we are putting the data itself. That's the for all the Arbeitszeiten. We are just using the method we created in here. Yeah, we are just it's like to put a puzzle into the right place. Yeah. That's the specific data because it's like the spreadsheet. Yeah. It's this one. And if you go in here, so it will change the description of that. But it will really append something and not only put some description. This method is only, or in quotas, only setting a description, but it's pretty useful for sure. But to make it a little bit smarter, we implemented it, a method. It's called append description with date time. We are putting the metadata map, we are putting the child ID and also what has to be appended. Yeah. And then we are appending the stuff into it. Yeah. We are appending, which kind of data is already in there. That's why we are putting the metadata map. There we get the actual description. Let's get in here. If the description already has the data in it, so it goes out. It has already put something, so we are going out. If the code is comfortable and okay, then that will be also okay for test purposes. We need to delete the data in between for sure the description, but for this small kind of change, it's not a big deal. We have a second one, the ID. The ID, we just need to put it into set description because it's awaiting it. And the append text, also which kind of text do we want to append to the existing description. So we are taking the description, yeah, and here, say if the description is null, so we are giving it a value. And so we are going to the set description, set the, this file, what we figure out in here. Yeah, and give me the description that is already existing. Give me two lines of code, say system.now. Yeah. Because that's just the date time stamp. And then append the text. And that's fine. That's all the stuff we need. That's pretty much the same in here. That's a acceptance criteria. We're just putting not the child ID 3, because the child ID 3 is related to all the data, or just like the files here. Yeah. In here, above here, here at this point, it can be a folder or something else. Only here we are sure that it's about a spreadsheet or something. Yeah, because we verified it here, yeah, with the condition. And that's why we can put a description for the file. And here we know that's about the child ID 2, yeah, as written in here as a folder, because we verified it here. Yeah, we have the child ID 2 above here, this one, child ID 2. We are using the child ID 2 here. And now we in here we are getting the metadata from child ID 2 because we're using it in a set file ID. Get description and MIME type. And so we get the MIME type 2 for the name 2. And here we are verifying that's about a folder and also the Arbeitszeiten. And if it is written correctly, then we append the data time in it. So the same in here, just above. If the Arbeitszeiten folder has been put, then also the upper folder will be put. Yeah. Just like this one, yeah, that's going up, and also putting some data into here. Here is the Arbeitszeiten, here's the Yamamanka, yeah. And then we also need to put something into the upper folder, yeah, into the, what is that called? Where does it belong? Yeah. In this folder, yeah. I would say we just also putting something into this folder. But we need to put it in a different kind of way. And so that's the first thing we need to change by now. So until here, I explained something. Now we're changing a little bit, yeah. The append with data time, I've recognized then that we are just going through the data, And then the description is being changed. But if the description is changed, or it's just verifying if the description, let me see, that's this one. If the description here already has this one in here, yeah, that's just verifying it in the condition in here. Yeah? Because if it's in there, it's returning, and then it's not putting any data into it. For those data in here, for this, oh no, I think for folders we should put it out, but for the data itself, yeah, that's fine, I think, that's okay. And but it's not okay for the folders, because the folders need to have more information and also more descriptions. So I will just do it like this, overload the methods, give it the same name because it's overloaded. Give it also the same amount of or the same parameters, and then we are putting another. They're just like a boolean, I would say, a boolean, and then true. Now, let's say it's folder, okay. Now let's say to append whatever happens. To append always, I would say. Because if it's always, then it's not going to return this one, and it's always putting a description into it. And if we have some folders that we want to have always, yeah, this one, that's like true. I would say here and here also true. And here we can leave it alone. We can say false, but we can leave this one alone because we are just doing it. Yeah. In the method itself, in the overloaded method, I will show you. So we are using it in here, here and here, just to make sure that we don't miss anything, but we didn't miss. And so we overloaded this one. Yeah, I just extended this method with one parameter. And so we are calling this one by just calling the method itself. The three parameters will be the same. Second one is ID, which just put it in like this. The append text, whatever, doesn't take too much time. And the basic stuff is like false. If you have a big amount of used methods, you can say you put in false and the basic is true, but at this point it didn't matter. So it was one true more. I think it's fine. Basically, it shouldn't be appended. That's why I put it false, but maybe it can be that you need to make it the other way around because it's quicker. Yeah? But at this point, it didn't matter. Later on, it can make a change and can make a difference for sure. But at that point, that doesn't really make it a difference. And so we just put this one into here and just made sure that every single method uses this parameter in any kind of way. And that's why it's overloaded. We are using the same signature. It's like name and then the name of the parameters. And then we are just saying and not this one. And then we are using it and then it's verifying if it happens or not. Okay, for this time it should be enough because we about to have the time. I will go on tomorrow with this one and all only with you, so don't be afraid. You will not you won't miss anything. You will you have the code right there all the time, and we won't have a different code for this. Yeah, thank you for your attention. If you have any questions, just let me know via email at this point. Whenever the YouTube video is online, I guess I will let you know. I will just put it into the meeting today, and then we'll say the meeting or the YouTube video is online, and then you get to know for sure. Have a nice evening, and hear you tomorrow.